Again, we extend a warm welcome to you on behalf of Dingwall and Strathpeffer Free Church and Ferintosh and Risollis Free Church as we worship in conjunction with each other in gospel fellowship over these days. So thank you for joining us. We are delighted to have you with us. Now, this evening, we're going to consider Satan's ruthlessness and Job's steadfastness against the backcloth of Job chapter 2. Join us again next Sunday at 11 and at 6. Now, our call to worship, the words of Psalm 68, praise to the Lord, our Savior God, our burdens daily he relieves. Of our salvation, he is God, truly he is the God who saves. And we respond to this call to worship as we sing to the praise of God, Psalm 116. The Lord, our God, is kind and full of grace, both righteous and compassionate is he. And so on, to the praise of God. Near to God in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, our Father in heaven, we come before you in the name of the Lord Jesus, our atoning sacrifice. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. The Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has triumphed. Our Lord Jesus is victorious. Death is swallowed up in his victory. We praise you, gracious God, our Father in heaven, for Calvary, for the empty tomb. We praise you. We worship you in the name of our King and Head, ascended and exalted on high. To whom else can we go? Jesus alone has the words of eternal life. In and through him, we can live life to the full, life with purpose, life with meaning, life with fulfillment in Christ alone. For from him and through him and for him are all things. To him be the glory forever, world without end. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall the troubles and hardship of COVID-19? No, says the Apostle Paul. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. So we pray, Lord God, that you would keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith. For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. We pray this evening that you would bless the gospel. Bless all who proclaim the good news of Jesus. Again, we remember specific congregations that we are encouraged to pray for. We pray for the work of the gospel in Broughty Ferry and Glenurchard and Fort Augustus. We pray, Lord God, that you would bless both Alberto and Sean in their respective ministries, and we pray for their every encouragement in the gospel. Again, we remember all who are affected by the coronavirus, from frontline workers to key workers in a variety of fields. We want to remember those who may be finding lockdown mentally challenging. Draw near to those with mental health illnesses, those who may be struggling to adapt and cope with self-isolation. Grant all such to know your peace and your protection. Enable us to say, along with the psalmist, "When hard pressed, I cried to the Lord. He brought me into a spacious place. The Lord is with me. I will not be afraid." We thank you for your covenant faithfulness. You will never leave us. You will never abandon us when we trust unreservedly in you. Pardon us anew for all of our shortcomings, our failings, and our wrongdoings. We pray that you would cleanse us from all sin and unrighteousness. And all we ask is in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Now we're going to read the Word of God together. Turn with me, please, if you will, to the book of Job and chapter 2. Job chapter 2, this is God's word. On another day, the angels came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came with them to present himself before him. And the Lord said to Satan, "Where have you come from?" Satan answered the Lord, "From roaming throughout the earth, going to and fro on it." Then the Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? There is no one on earth like him. He is blameless and upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil. And he still maintains his integrity, though you incited me against him to ruin him without any reason." "Skin for skin," Satan replied. "A man will give all he has for his own life. But now stretch out your hand and strike his flesh and bones, and he will surely curse you to your face." The Lord said to Satan, "Very well then, he is in your hands, but you must spare his life." So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and afflicted Job with painful sores from the soles of his feet to the crown of his head. Then Job took a piece of broken pottery and scraped himself with it as he sat among the ashes. His wife said to him, "Are you still maintaining your integrity? Curse God and die." He replied, "You are talking like a foolish woman. Shall we accept good from God and not trouble?" In all this, Job did not sin in what he said. When Job's three friends, Eliphaz, the Temanite, Bildad, the Shuhite, and Zophar, the Naamathite, heard about all the troubles that had come upon him, they set out from their homes and met together by agreement to go and sympathize with him and comfort him. When they saw him from a distance, they could hardly recognize him. They began to weep aloud, and they tore their robes and sprinkled dust on their heads. Then they sat on the ground with him for 7 days and seven nights. No one said a word to him because they saw how great his suffering was. Amen. And we trust that God will add his blessing to the reading of his own holy and inspired word. Well, let's revisit the book of Job. We were there last week. You will recall that last week we considered Job's devastation and devotion, or devotion in devastation. So we're asking the question, what lessons can we learn from Job's personal suffering? What does faith in adversity look like? What is faith that endures? Well, tonight we're going to continue from where we left off last week. We're going to compare and contrast Satan's ruthlessness with Job's steadfastness. Now, Job has passed his first testing ordeal, as is highlighted in chapter 1. He has survived Satan's gauntlet. He has lost nothing of his integrity. At no point does Job curse God. Now, there is much encouragement to be drawn from the dark depths of this somewhat complex book of the Old Testament, because grace prevails. We see it already. It galvanizes us and spurs us on, as it does in the experience of Job. Grace enables us to stand and to withstand all that confronts us with the steadfastness of Job. So, verse 10 is our text. In all this, Job did not sin in what he said. So let's explore chapter 2 from a twofold perspective: Satan's ruthlessness and Job's steadfastness. Well, evidently, as we turn the page, as we come to chapter 2, we immediately see that Satan does not give up easily. He is not satisfied. Notice what Satan says in verse 4. Skin for skin, he shouts, implying that Job's godliness is one big act. As before, Satan implies that Job is faithful only because he has known God's blessing in his life. And look at verses 4 and 5. Satan brings this to a very personal level and makes a further brutal accusation. Job was willing to accept the loss of his own family, his property, his livestock, so long as his own skin was left unscathed and intact. In other words, Job is only interested in himself and safeguarding his own personal interests, again insinuating that Job's faith is self-centered and self-gratifying, and that at best Job is simply subscribing to some kind of prosperity theology. Well, verse 5, Satan again wishes to prove his point. Stretch out your sovereign hand, he says to God. Strike this man's flesh and bones. No longer cradle Job. And then Satan says, he will surely curse you to your face. You see, Satan is confident that physical pain, bodily suffering, will be enough to bring Job to breaking point. Let's call it the domino effect. physical blow after blow will affect and destabilize Job's mental and emotional well-being. This will in turn rattle his spiritual framework, and he will then relent. Job will surrender. He'll collapse in a heap and curse God. The domino effect. One of the most disturbing books I've read recently is Forgotten Voices of the Holocaust by Lynn Smith. In this book, several Nazi concentration camps are profiled. Physical torture and pain is not uncommon, but what stands out is that physical torture and pain included prolonged hunger and starvation for many Jews. Stale bread, rotten, moldy potatoes at best. Starvation drove men to insanity as their bodies wasted away and infection and disease took its toll. So the mind of these men became increasingly fragile. Men emerge emotionally broken and spiritually shattered, drained of hope, and resigned to dying, and sometimes longing for death to envelop them in their suffering. The domino effect. And we see something of this fragility factor in Job. In fact, it's in us all. Satan is given here a warrant to inflict physical pain on Job, but again, Satan is on a leash of divine sovereignty. Verse 6, he is told by God, you must spare his life. So again, he's not permitted to interfere with Job's soul. It's out of bounds. Job's soul is an exclusion zone. And whilst he can inflict injury, he's not permitted to take Job's life. Now again, there's encouragement there for us, and we'll come back to this in a moment. Now, from verse 7 in chapter 2, as before, you will see that Satan wastes no time. He ruthlessly inflicts indescribable anguish and pain in the experience of Job, taking full advantage of his license to strike, and there is no mercy. He strikes Job, we read, with painful sores from head to toe, everywhere. His body is infested with pus-filled, seeping, bleeding boils, bringing excruciating pain and misery to every part and fiber of his being. It's quite repugnant, detestable, vile, and loathsome to the eye. Job is an utterly horrible sight to behold, as is verified in verse 12, when the three comforters come on the scene. Even from a distance, they don't recognize Job anymore. And notice that Satan keeps a close eye on Job's pain threshold, waiting for Job to crack and curse God. But it doesn't happen. But Satan has many strategies. Look at verse 9. To add insult to injury, Satan uses Job's wife, who appears to be the only surviving member of his immediate family circle, and for good reason, from Satan's viewpoint, because he will use Job's wife to provoke Job and persuade Job to curse God and die. Now, there is here a disturbing comparison. The language and scene that unfolds here in Job chapter 2 is very similar to the language of the fall in the Garden of Eden back in Genesis 3. So I want us just to draw this comparison because it's intriguing as well as disturbing. You see, Satan's great goal is to bring a curse, as he did back in Eden, and to come between Job and God and sever their bond and union, just as he came between Adam and God back in Genesis 3. And Satan tries to use Job's wife to tempt Job, just as he used Eve to tempt Adam. You see, death is always Satan's ultimate goal. That was the case in Eden, and it hasn't changed here. Now, perhaps Job's wife thinks that her husband, Job, is as good as dead anyway, that there's little hope of recovery for her suffering spouse. But it's a cruel blow from Job's perspective. This could be the straw that breaks the camel's back, Satan is thinking. But remarkably, it isn't. It's not the final straw. Job's faith endures. And at this point, don't the words of the Apostle Paul resonate with us from 1 Corinthians 10:13? When Paul says, "No temptation whatsoever has overtaken you and I except what is common to mankind." And God is faithful, Paul says. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, like Job, he will also provide a way out so that you can endure it. Now, this is most reassuring for you and I. It's also a truth that is reinforced repeatedly throughout the book of Job. And we're only at chapter 2. So let's move on, secondly, to consider Job's steadfastness. Unlike Adam back in the Garden of Eden, Job stands this subtle and cunning satanic test. He sees it through. Notice what he does. He rebukes his wife for her foolishness. The word foolish here, actually, it alludes to faithlessness or even apostasy, which is pretty serious. Job asks a decisive question of his wife in verse 10. Shall we, on the one hand, accept good from God and not trouble or adversity on the other hand? It's remarkable, isn't it? Job discerns in this moment that adversity, affliction, suffering, that his day of trouble is to be expected. Suffering does not necessarily represent punishment for sin. The meaning and significance of suffering goes much wider and deeper than that. It's a complex component. At times, it's difficult to unpack, and trying to unpack the meaning of suffering against the backcloth of the book of Job can be challenging at times. You see, for God's people, suffering, adversity, it may serve as a trial, as here, or as a form of discipline that is ultimately for our spiritual benefit. But I want us to notice that there is a satanic element to Job's suffering. Yet, God rules, God overrules in his absolute sovereignty. This is not the end for Job. It's a means to an end, a glorious ending, which Job can't see, at least not yet. The God of Job is the God of Romans 8:28, and he is at work here when Paul declares that all things work together for the good of those who love God, he means precisely that. Even the satanic strategies of hell itself will be frustrated and ultimately used for our good by God, as we see that unfold in the personal experience of Job. And there is encouragement there for us. The reformer John Calvin, at a time of personal discouragement in his own life, could say, "Let us look at Satan. Let's look at Satan in the eye and discover that all our spiritual enemies are already vanquished, and assure ourselves beforehand that God will make us triumph in the midst of our battles." And does Jesus not say, "I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not, under any circumstances, prevail"? Notice that Job, in verse 10, is vindicated. In all this we read, Job did not sin in what he said. It is remarkable. However, his suffering does not go away. Job has to endure long-term affliction. You discover that as you continue to turn the pages of this book. And the extent of his personal suffering cannot be emphasized enough. I mean, look at verse 8. It's a very sad, crushing picture of his agony, even at this early stage. There he is with a piece of broken pottery, scraping and scratching himself, sitting on a heap of ashes, lamenting. And let's be clear, he's still mourning. He's grief-stricken in light of the loss of his family. And there follows chapter after chapter after chapter of intense suffering, which is unbearable at times, even for you and I to read. But faith, his faith, the faith of Job, endures. This great truth, as we come to a close, it's ingrained in this dark book, where personal suffering reaches low points that few of us can comprehend, but then lower still, even at Job's lowest point, God is present. His everlasting arms remain outstretched, bearing Job up. He doesn't leave or forsake or abandon Job in any way, even though it may not feel like that from Job's perspective. Yet faith endures. One lonely set of footprints in the sand of Job's suffering would suggest that Job is very much on his own. Here is a man in self-isolation. Here is a man socially distanced in a satanic lockdown. However, he will come to realize that he has not been abandoned, and that he too will hear the reassuring words, "When you saw but one set of footprints, it was then, Job, that I carried you." And as we explore the book of Job, we are at times left with more questions than answers. Yes, we are. And sometimes we simply don't fully understand why there is so much suffering around us. Why do I suffer? Why does he suffer? Why does she suffer? The challenge for us all, just like Job, is to trust God in spite of our deep and profound unanswered questions. This is faith that endures in adversity, trusting the God of Romans 8:28. Let's leave the last word with the prophet Habakkuk. There we see him in light of his own personal scene of devastation, How does he respond? Not unlike Job. Yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God, my Savior. Satan's ruthlessness, Job's steadfastness, ultimately, for us all, for our encouragement, it's about faith that endures. Amen. Well, let's bring our service now to a close as we sing the very apt words of "He will hold me fast." When I fear my faith will fail, Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter would prevail, he will hold me fast. To God's praise.
He will hold me fast for my sake.
May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit remain with us all. Amen.